So we're doing the $125 gaming PC video again. Now the idea behind that PC is that you don't have to buy a new gaming PC to get good performance, and if you don't have a lot of money, the best way actually to get a good gaming experience is to upgrade your existing gaming PC and get really good performance, maybe equivalent to a PlayStation 4 or even higher. So I guess you can build a PC equivalent to that one, but if you don't know the specs of this PC, let's run down through them pretty quick, right? So for the CPU, we're looking at a 2nd gen Pentium G2020, I don't think you know that CPU, and this is based on LGA's 1155 socket, so I could easily upgrade to an i3 or an i5, which seems to be the best way actually to upgrade that PC, cause there is a huge bottleneck in a lot of games that limits our GPU, which in this case we're looking at the RX 460, which I got for $70. I thought that the RX 460 will come without a need of a 6-pin power connector, but this one came with one, so I had to upgrade the power supply. But yeah, there wasn't anything wrong with the old PSU, but the only thing wrong actually is that it had a dead Molex pin connector, so the GPU didn't work properly. So I bought a new one for about $6. I mean, power supplies are pretty cheap in here, and it has an 8-pin power connector, and I guess that this one is a 500 watt power supply because it has the same voltage as the old one. So now, speaking of the overall performance of the PC itself, I guess you can get a gaming PC equivalent to that one. It doesn't have to be an RX 460, you can get a GPU like the HD 7870 or even the 7850 for somewhere between $30 to $60, and always rely on local deals. Even though it's not as good as you think, you just keep searching and you'll find a really good deal. Like for example, I found a GTX 660 for $50, which is a thing that you don't find that often in my region. So yeah, you'll always find some great deals on PC ports no matter where you live. Now, what are the upgrades I would do to this PC? Now, first of all, I would change the CPU, because the CPU is bottlenecking the RX 460. It's a dual core CPU, but it's not good enough, so I would change it to an i3, which is somewhere between $20 to $25. I guess dual cores are not as good as they were. I mean, games are getting more demanding, and I guess it's not the time for dual cores anymore. You'll have a lot of frame rate stutters. But if you're stuck with a dual core CPU, I guess you don't have to get an RX 460, maybe get something like a GTX 750 Ti or a GTX 660, something lower than the RX 460 itself, that will not bottleneck as much as the RX 460 does. Now yeah, having a well-rounded PC is much better than getting a PC with a really badass GPU and a CPU that cannot keep up, cause you'll not get good frame rates and you're sort of wasting your money. I mean, if you pair this CPU with an RX 470, you will not get good frame rates, and you'll not be even close to a GPU like the GTX 1050 Ti. To get a good gaming experience is to buy a GPU and put it in your PC, and then you upgrade the PC parts you have. Unless you have a really old system that you cannot upgrade, like for example a Pentium 4 PC, you really need to get a new gaming PC. With that said, it brings us to the next part of that video, which is, you've all been waiting for, it's the benchmarks, and we're testing 10 games. Now, there are some things I want you to keep in mind. First of all, the footage you're about to watch are pretty horrible, and I meant to do that because I was recording on the MSI Afterburner. So yeah, the footage will look really horrible, even though they're not. They are really good, really satisfying when you look at it in person. This is just a showcase of performance. Maybe in another video, I will give you some crispy footage, but for now, it sucks. Second thing you want to keep in mind that you'll get higher frame rates than what you're looking at right now, especially in the CPU intensive games. When you're recording, it actually takes about 5 to 10 frame rates per second, which is pretty significant. The third thing you want to keep in mind is all of the games were tested at 1080p ultra settings with anti-aliasing off, and also the shadows and textures may be turned down, and that's because I wanted to give you stable footage. And even if you cranked the textures and shadows to ultra, you'll get stable 30 frames per second. But can it run? And I was actually pleasantly surprised by benchmarking that game. I thought I'd get really horrible graphics because it's a pretty old game, but when I played it at 1080p ultra settings and with shadows turned down to high and water detail turned down to high, the game looks pretty good, even though it's about 10 years old. We're getting a stable 30 frames per second, even though we're looking at a lot of stutters right now, but again, only because I'm recording. And the Crysis is a pretty CPU and GPU intensive game, and again, anti-aliasing turned off. You can easily hit 60 frames per second on Crysis, but I'd rather play it at ultra settings than getting 60 frames per second. I mean, it looks really good. So the PC is good, right? Well, yeah, it is. But how about we get into some AAA titles? But not just any AAA title. A AAA title with a disappointing results. Yes, we're looking at Battlefield 1, and unfortunately we cannot hit 60 frames per second. Now, I am pretty sure that there is an issue with that game, needs to be fixed, and I'll do another video soon where I'll test that game in detail. But at 1080p high settings, we're getting a stable 30 frames per second. What you're looking at right now is 1080p medium settings, and in a minute or two I got about 60 frames per second, but then I went down to 30 frames per second again. And I guess that the CPU usage is higher than it should be, because there are other open world game where I got better frame rates. So yeah, there must be something wrong with these benchmarks. I was setting the resolution scale to 65%. It really sucks to play that game at 30 frames per second, that's all I can say. But to make you feel better, I was actually able to play at 1800p low settings, and I got about 25 to 30 frames per second. So there is some hope. And yeah, there is a huge bottleneck with this game. I mean, when you look at the RX 460 benchmarks, you find that on ultra settings you can get an average 46 frames per second. So yeah, if you turn down these settings too high, you'll get a stable 60 frames per second, but that's with a better CPU. This CPU is literally killing the experience, but that doesn't mean that there isn't something wrong with the game, so I'll look further more into it in another video. But let's get to an open world game which got a really impressive results. It's Far Cry Primal, and we are playing at 1080p ultra settings, but only shadows set to high. And yeah, I could have set the shadows to very high or ultra and still get some really impressive results, but I decided to play it like this so I can give you some stable frame rates again. And yeah, we're getting about 30 to 45 frames per second. I didn't have a lot of dippings actually. And this is an open world game, meaning that it's a pretty CPU intensive game. So yeah, that may convince you that there was something wrong with Battlefield 1. So let's keep the trend with another open world game, and then we'll go to some indie games that are actually pretty good and I'd recommend you to play them, and then we'll get back to AAA games. Let's look at a Bethesda game. The Elder Scrolls Skyrim Remastered Edition, and at 1080p ultra settings we are getting stable 30 frames per second. With shadows turned down to high, I was getting 30 frames per second. But I guess 60 frames per second in that game isn't that possible. And that's what Bethesda is known for, they make some really cool games. And yeah, I guess I'm done with Skyrim. Let's get to another visually satisfying game. It's an Unreal Engine game, it has a really good story behind it, and it's called Firewatch. So this game is powered by Unreal Engine 4, and Unreal Engine 4 is known for being not that demanding on the PC itself. So we're playing at 1080p ultra settings and we're getting about 30 to 45 frames per second again. There isn't a lot of settings in this game, and this is the crispiest footage you look at of them all. I mean, I didn't really care about having some frames dipping at the time, and it will look really good on your monitor. So yeah, I'd recommend you to get that game. Yeah, it's kind of romantic, I haven't got that much into it, but yeah, it's a really good game. So next is another Unreal Engine 4 game, and it's called Rime. It's that sound enriching game with some good art design, and you have to solve some puzzles. But anyway, at 1080p medium to high settings, I was getting about 30 frames per second. Yeah, it's really demanding game. Let's get into another indie game with no story and no campaign or anything like that. Just a good idea behind it that made it really famous. Cause playing sucks. That's Rocket League, my friends. And we're playing at 720p ultra settings, and we're getting really crazy framers. Are we getting somewhere between 120 to 150 frames per second? So that's really crazy, and the game looks really good. But I guess I'm not going under 60 frames per second if I played that game at 1080. And as you can see, I really suck at this game, and yeah, you shouldn't watch more. Let's get it with Killing Floor 2. Now, I really enjoyed playing that game, and I was playing at 1080p medium to high settings, and I was getting 60 frames per second. Now, this game is really fun to play, as I said. In some intensive moments, frames were going down to about 30 frames per second, but it's a really good game. It's a really fun game to play, and having 60 frames per second is no problem with this PC, even though there are some frame rates dipping. Yeah, this CPU cannot give you stable performance. But again, 1080p 60 frames per second was possible with the RX 460, and I guess if I cranked it up too high, I would get about the same frame rates, but maybe with a better CPU. How about we look at a game that's a fan favorite? Yes, we're looking at Rise of the Tomb Raider, and we're getting some really high frame rates. At 1080p ultra settings, again with anti-aliasing turned off, I was getting a really healthy stable frame rates per second. I was getting somewhere between 30 to 45 frames per second. I jumped into another section and I got about the same frame rates. So yeah, you might want to check that game out if you are getting into PC gaming. You have to play that game. So as you can see, we could have gone for higher resolution using AMD's virtual super resolution technology. So yeah, there are a lot of things can be done with this game. Now, let's get into another open world game. To access, to weight the positive, elim, minate the negative, latch on. Again, yeah, it's Fallout 4, and I don't know, every time I play that game, I feel like I'm watching A Beautiful Mind. I don't know why, there is something wrong with me, I don't know. But at 1080p ultra settings with no settings reduced, I was getting frame rates between 30 to 45 frames. Even though it's another open world game and it's from Bethesda, I got good frame rates actually, and better than what I've got on Skyrim. And we're only playing on dual core and getting that type of performance, so that's really good. So yeah, 10 games tested. Well, do you really think we're done yet? The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, a GPU intensive game that showcases how powerful the RX 460 is, and we were playing at 1080p ultra settings, and we were getting a stable 30 frames per second, actually a bit. I just love everything about the game. This is the game that I've enjoyed it the most, and yeah, best for last. So with that said, is this a good gaming PC? Yeah, it's a great gaming PC for the price. And yeah, we're playing games at 1080p ultra settings and getting about 30 frames per second. Even a Battlefield 1 was a huge letdown. You couldn't complain, you're paying $125. But to be honest, if I'm keeping this PC, I would upgrade the CPU to an i3. And if you have an LGA 1155 base PC and you don't have an i3 or anything like that, please do not downgrade to a quad core PC. Why you're doing so? That's not legit. I mean, not because the quad core is a quad core CPU that means you should downgrade to it. Yeah, the i3 would give actually somewhat better performance. But I could have saved a lot of money and got a GPU like the HD 787 for $50. I think I'd get about the same performance. So yeah, I don't want to make that video any longer to you guys. Let me know what you think in the comments down below, and subscribe to see more gaming builds like this. And also let me know, what do you want to see in the future? What game do you want me to test on this PC before I get rid of it? And the next video will be comparing this PC against the PlayStation 4 Pro. It's really crazy, but hell yeah, we're doing it. See ya soon.